All right, Coach Flash, welcome to Tex Talks. How are you?
I'm good. How are you doing, Coachy?
I'm great, man. I'm great. All our schoolboy coaches are starting off these things with a massive smile because we got the great news that we're back on the field very, very soon. So I'm sure you're just as excited as I am.
Yeah, that's the thing, man. I'm holding fingers. I'm holding everything I can for this season to happen. Missing last year wasn't great at all. So really excited for rugby to be back.
Yeah, it was the worst year probably I've had in a long time. Two or three coaching sessions and one game. It sucked. But yeah, hopefully 2021 has got a lot more rugby in it. Schoolboy rugby in it.
Definitely. We also had just a week of practice and we had a total nail sprite. And after that was it. So yeah, feel sorry for the boys. Feel sorry for everyone that loves the game, actually.
Yeah, definitely. Coach Flash, if we jump into it, yeah, we're going to spend the first part of the interview in just getting to know you as a person and your views on life and things you like. And then we'll get into the deep waters of rugby coaching, obviously. So let's start off with a simple one. Who is Coach Flash?
Yeah, first and foremost, I think I am a father. I have a 5-year-old son. I am married. I've been married for 7 years now, and to my wife, Buipelo. And yeah, I'm a teacher, I'm an educator by profession, and obviously a passionate rugby coach. I'm a learner of the game, and I love it so much.
Yeah, cool. And that's the whole point of this whole podcast, is to talk to guys like you that have a massive passion for the schoolboy game. So why are you so passionate about the schoolboy game? What is it about schoolboy rugby that grabs your focus and grabs your attention?
I don't think there's any rugby at any level that can go as far as beating schoolboy rugby. I think schoolboy rugby is where the magic happens, where the true passion lies. You know, seeing the Saturday morning boys really excited to play rugby. That's life in itself. I really enjoy that. I enjoy coaching it as well. Just to educate the boys on the field. And painting them a picture at practice and seeing them do it in the match. That's for me very, very, very nice.
Awesome. So was schoolboy coaching or rugby coaching in general always a part of your plan?
Right. So at first I obviously played. And when I hung up my boots, not playing anymore, something was missing. And, I went back to playing a little bit. But because I'm an educator and I work with schoolboys, it was a no-brainer for me to start coaching and be involved in the game again. It wasn't by choice. I think whatever would have happened, I would have ended up being a schoolboy rugby coach because I so love it so much.
Deur 'n krisis tyd gaan of deur 'n tyd gaan waar dit moeilik is en ons almal gaan daardeur dan en ek hou op en ek raak besig en ek hou op om vir myself te sê elke oggend dan is dit asof die jy was 'n bietjie van 'n meer van 'n vashou mens kry word vinniger negatief dis moeilik om situasies te hanteer en net nou al 'n paar keer met my gebeur en dan die oomblik wanneer ek elke oggend myself weer herinner hoe hanteer ek uitdagings wat 'n tipe mens wil ek wees dan hanteer ek daai situasies van self net ek heeltemal anders rond, ek heeltemal 'n ander mindset het rondom dit. So vir my is dit ongelooflik belangrik en enige mens se sukses is hoe begin jy jou dag en hoe begin jy weet daai deur te sê wie is ek, waar is ek op pad en wat wil ek bereik vir die dag. I believe, especially if you've played the game and you've become an educator afterwards, it's kind of the next holistic step in developing the boys into becoming great humans is to go onto the field and get to know them outside of the classroom, get to know them personally a little bit better. And that's where those bonds are created between player and coach, right?
No, definitely. I used to look up to school teachers and especially those who were rugby coaches. Those were sort of my father figures growing up. And so once I stepped into that space, it was inevitable that I'm going to be one as well.
Yes, absolutely. So Flash, the listeners have listened to the introduction, and we've heard where you've been involved with provincial schoolboy level and also an EPD coach, a club coach. So you're very involved in the game. Why do you think you're so successful? Why have you been able to make it, you know, be a varsity coach, be a provincial coach, be part of the EPD system? What brought Flash to the dance?
Yeah, I think it's part of learning as well. So as I do, I learn as well. So I share a lot of information, but I also give out a lot of the information that I know. And so as people grow each other, I think as I'm talking to you right now, I could learn one or two things about rugby from you, you know, and obviously share it somewhere. So it's just being coachable as a coach as well.
Yeah.
And learning from others and obviously sharing. I think that's what got me to where I am.
Awesome. So, Coach, before we jump into the deep waters of coaching, let's hit you with some quick fire questions to get to know Flash a little bit better. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Cool. All right. Favorite band or song?
Has to be... So, the favorite song will be from Tupac, which is Unconditional Love.
Nice.
Yeah, that's sick. And favorite band, I'll have to go with R&B, Boyz II Men.
Oh, a soulful man. I love it. Favorite food?
It has to be kota. So kota is that kasi ban chow, if you can call it like that. Yeah, with a whole lot of mixed everything put into a quarter of a loaf. Yeah, so kota, a very good kota. It's definitely my favorite.
Oh, I love those. I love it when some of our parents make those for like a after-match snack. It's just this, all that sauce goes into the bread. Oh, it's just great. It's awesome. Oh, I love it too.
Nah, 100%, 100%.
I'm getting hungry now. Favorite color?
It has to be black. I actually like driving black cars. Yeah, so I would say definitely a black color for me is, you can't go wrong with it.
Cool. Your drink of choice?
I prefer cold water, you know, when I'm thirsty. Okay. But if I may, I love a bit of whiskey as well, Jack Daniels to be specific. But yeah, nothing beats a glass of water.
Cool. Yeah, interesting. Your favorite movie?
It has to be Set It Off. 90s classic, you know, with Jada Pinkett and those girls. Set It Off, I think I enjoyed it when I was young, and I wouldn't mind watching it over and over and over again. It's definitely one of a kind. That's my favorite, all-time favorite movie, Set It Off.
Awesome. What's the name of the very first team you ever coached?
The very first team that I've ever coached was actually a Coke team from HTS Nick Diederix. Yeah, it was very interesting because I was starting up as a teacher, and I was an assistant coach there to a coach called Monty Benefeld, of which I learned a lot in terms of coaching from him. And yeah, after that, I literally took, I think we coached I coached the Coke team and then assisted the first team. And after that, I coached a team from under 14 all the way to first team at the very first school that I taught at, which is RTS, Nick Diederix and crew as well.
Awesome. Dream job?
Yeah, to be a Springbok coach. Definitely. No doubt to wear the colors of green and gold. Yeah, that's my all-time dream job, hands down.
Cool. Yeah, that is the ultimate dream. Your favorite quote?
It goes like this: after every dark night comes a brighter day. So after every dark night comes a brighter day. That gets me. Whenever I'm feeling sad or anything like that, if I just remember that quote, it just tells me that there will be the light at the end of the channel. Awesome. Yeah, it's what I go through every single time that I'm not in a good space.
Cool. Forwards or backs?
Look, I really love the back line players. You know, there's a lot of action in the back line, a lot of creativity. But I don't think back line would happen if it wasn't for the forwards. So even though I prefer the creativity in the back line, I am thankful that there is a group of guys called forwards who would do all the dirty job for the smart guys at the back.
What a great diplomatic answer from a coach that doesn't want to upset any of his big forwards. Right, so attack or defense?
Definitely attack. I think I have a creative mind, and I love the idea of stressing the opposition. You know, coming up with something different. Mm. Be it around the corner, be it on the edges, something creative, just so that the game can flow, and you know, to give in that creative brand of rugby. Definitely, I would prefer attack than defense.
Awesome. Rainbow Cup or Super Rugby?
Sure. I'm a Southern Hemisphere through and through. So, I think the competition that especially South African teams, New Zealand teams, Australian teams, and to such an extent, Argentina, you can't beat that. So if you give me a choice, I'll choose Super Rugby, definitely. I think the competition there is high. I think the competition is healthy, and I just love watching the Super Rugby.
Awesome. I think you've touched on this next one already, but let's get a full official answer. Coach the Springboks for 100,000 rand a year, or coach the English national team for 10 million bucks a year?
Bro, I'll even go as far as coaching the Springboks for free.
How far.
The green and gold, all, you know, through and through. Coach, that's an easy choice, actually. I'd go for the Springboks for that 100,000.
Definitely. Role models and mentors?
So role model is a guy by the name of Billy Benefield. Funny enough, it's a guy I coached with at Heron Bridge College, a school teacher and a rugby coach as well. I think he's got his life together. That's why he's actually my role model. The people that I look up to, can I give you maybe five coaches?
Of course you can.
That I really think they've done something nice. First and foremost, Sean Erasmus, who's up here at the Lions. You know, he's done some wonderful things as a schoolboy rugby when he was in KZN and when he was in the Western Cape. So definitely Sean Erasmus. David Manuel, who's at the Bulls at the moment. You know, I'd give him a phone call every time I need some advice. Bafana Nhleko, who's the SA under 20 head coach. I think, that's also another cool, calm and collected guy who I'd pick up a phone or send him a text whenever I need some guidance in the rugby space. Joey Mangalo, who's at the Bulls. I think he's one of the greatest coaches that we've seen in this country. And he's doing amazing thing. And lastly would be Khumane Boy, who moved from the Eastern Cape and is now with the Pumas. So those five coaches, I would say those are my mentors.
Awesome collection of guys. If you're not very familiar with the deep waters of coaching, you won't know those names. But those of us that know those names, those are trendsetters in the industries. Joey and David are doing some different things at the Bulls. That's obviously working. If you look at the success over there with the under 21s last year winning, and with the success of the senior team. Kumani is also, I mean, the Pumas are a great team, and everybody thinks it's all Jimmy. No, it's not all Jimmy. Jimmy's got a lot of great people around him as well. Definitely. A couple of good guys you got there.
Nah, definitely, definitely. See, it's not all about the head coach. I mean, the head coach, yes, it starts with him and it ends with him as well. But in a team, there's those guys in the background who are grinding very hard. And, you know, their bits of pieces make up the success of the team. So, yeah, I really look up to those five individuals.
Cool. So, last one here before we jump into the rugby stuff. Describe your character in one sentence.
A family man. A family, an easygoing family man.
Nice. Nice and simple. I love it. So, Coach Flash, let's get into the deep waters here. Let's talk about coaching philosophy. What is your view on coaching philosophy? How do you view the game? What's the cornerstones of your coaching system?
Yeah, look, going with the theme of me being an educator, my philosophy is definitely to educate and also to prepare. So when I'm on the rugby field, I'm there to educate players. And I'm also there to prepare, be it prepare them to become good citizens, prepare them to play a match or prepare them to go on tour. I'm there to prepare them and to educate, give them those skills that they need to succeed.
Awesome. 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 And a word that's become, or a phrase that's become very popular over the last year or two, is we talk about team culture. What are your views on team culture and how do you, what are the pillars you build your team cultures on?
Yeah, I think to have a culture, a healthy culture in a team, in any team, it's actually very, very important. You know, if you are not cultured, you know, you've got nothing to fall back on. So especially a group of guys who have a culture, I think can go very, very far with a season or anything like that. So what I usually do is I make sure before every season that I take this group of boys and we go somewhere. It shouldn't, even if it's not rugby related, we can go fishing, for example. But I take those guys and we go fishing there. That's when we get to know each other on a personal level. I believe that if you know each other on a personal level, then you can work better together. You know, you can have a healthy team culture, which will be something big to influence you to be successful.
Yeah, and I think a lot of coaches that have positive team cultures have noticed the difference in just purely effort that the boys put into it. Because they know each other better, there's more on the line for them because it's a personal thing. Where if you kind of just throw the guys together and they need to play and they never really get to know each other, you're not going to make that large stitched effort in the dying seconds of a game to make a tackle. It's not going to be that important to you. So team culture, I think there's a big relation between team culture and work ethic of a team, definitely.
You're absolutely right. I mean, if you take a group of boys and you just put them together and play, you know, I don't think that's a team. I think that's a group of individuals playing one sport. But if they get to know each other on a personal level, then that's when you have that unity. You know, I think team culture is actually that glue that binds a team together. Very, very important.
Right. So Coach Flash, I'm going to share my screen with you. Tell me if you can see that, and then we'll have a quick discussion on a couple of photos that I've got here. So tell me a story, share an emotion, talk us through.
If I'm not mistaken, that's the Golden Lions president team. That team was, if I'm not mistaken, 2013. So what the Lions are doing, they're taking all the development schools, you know, take all the boys from development schools and make one team, which will qualify to go and play in an Easter festival. And this is one of the teams in 2013 that ended up playing against the third best under 16 team in the country, which was Hartsfontein at the time. And we with these small school boys, we actually beat Hartsfontein, and you know, we actually got into that tournament without even losing a single match. What's interesting about this team, it was, I could name guys like Madosh Tambwe, who now plays for the Bulls, who was in this team. I could name Achiva Diamane, who was who now plays for the Lions. He was actually a schoolboy in this team as well. And there was also, yes, a couple of good guys in this team. This team was brilliant. I mean, it produced a lot of professional guys. And, you know, they were from a small school, and it shows you what talent lies in the development side of things.
Yeah, I think not just for the schoolboys, but also it creates also that extra opportunity for coaches to get involved into a kind of provincial setup nice and early. I think here's a couple of more shots from your time with the Lions. You've obviously spent a lot of years with the Lions. Talk us through your journey.
Yeah, red is a beautiful color. I've coached the Lions at at Gran Como level, which I spent a good 2 years there. I've coached at the Craven Week level as well. And I think one of the pictures there is the what we call the IPT team, which is the club side team. So I've been around when it comes to schoolboy. I really don't mind coaching, you know, at any level. But yeah, I've coached these boys, and it's sort of nice to actually speak to them as adults as well. Whether they now professional rugby players or not, it's actually just good to have a good chat and reminisce about the olden days. And as I say, it's a very good way for a coach to grow as well into that system.
Yeah, definitely. So Coach Flash, talk us through the first time you went to the National Week. I think it was the Gran Como team. The emotions, the preparation, how did you experience that very first year going to the National Weeks?
Yeah, firstly, more than anything, I was excited. Because I have been into a National Week as a player before. So my very first time going to a Gran Como Week, which I believe was in Van der Bijl Park. The emotions were very good. I was really excited, very excited to showcase what we have been preparing and whatnot, and to do what we have practiced at camp and so forth. Again, had very good team then. I remember players like Len Massain were in that team, and I think Wandisile Simelani as a 15-year-old was also in that team. And I also worked with very good coaches. A guy by the name of Forsey and was the head coach, and Fricky was our team manager. I was the backline coach there. Very excited, and I think I learned a lot about the level and the intensity that is required at the provincial, at the national level. So I really enjoyed it, and the games were amazing as well.
So then you made the jump to Craven Week. When you made the jump to Craven Week, some of those boys that you coach at Gran Como, obviously you met up with them again in the Craven Week. Obviously, it's good to see familiar faces, but talk to us about the difference between Gran Como and Craven Week.
So first and foremost, the ball is the same. It's the same rugby and everything. The only difference is the pressure. The pressure at Craven Week is huge. I mean, you now are no longer representing either just your school or your district. You're representing the union. The very best of the best in terms of schoolboy rugby in your province. So there's a lot of expectations that you have. So the level is huge. This was my very first time coaching Craven Week, was in 2015. I think I really enjoyed that tournament. Again, we had good players. We didn't have that success in terms of the campaign. If you remember then, the Lions just lost to the Sharks in the first game. I think we beat the Cheetahs, and we lost again to Esviadia. I can remember this clearly. They had Manny Lebok, and Manny Lebok was a 13 at the time. And yeah, he did some amazing stuff. But yeah, I mean, I was coaching boys that I've coached when they were juniors. It was so beautiful to see them having grown up into sort of first team level. Yeah, 2015 is one to remember for sure.
Were you involved in the 2017 Craven Week setup?
No. So in 2016, my son got born. And I sort of took a step back.
Okay.
I didn't coach rugby at all for the first 2 years of his life. You know, I dedicated all my life to family. And so I didn't coach Craven Week going forward then. And then I made my comeback again in 2018 when I coached the under 16s. And then I was fortunate enough in 2019 to be the head coach of the academy side, the Golden Lions academy side.
Awesome. So you've spent a lot of time in these national weeks. If you now, with the experience you've got, could talk to Flash that was part of that very first Grant Gomez setup, what advice would you give him?
Get a mentor. Get a mentor. Get someone who's been there, who's done what you are about to do. Talk to them. Ask them every single question that you are not sure of. I believe I didn't have a mentor back when I started my provincial coaching. And that's exactly what I would tell my younger self, to get a mentor.
Awesome. Flash, as we move away from the Lions chat, just one more question. Obviously, we are hopeful that we'll have a national tournament in 2021. How does the future of 2021 look for the Lions? Are you guys excited about the group you have potentially this year to take to a national week?
Yeah, I mean, we're currently busy with the high performance, and at the Lions high performance, those guys are doing amazing things. You can see the boys are hungry. You know, they're hungry to play, you know, since they didn't play last year, which means, you know, the future is bright. I think the campaign is good. The coaches that are there are brilliant coaches. And with the type of players that we have, I think we'll do some amazing work there.
Awesome. So Flash, the next slide is you with a couple of influential people. So maybe talk to us about coaches that have influenced your life, your learning experience, dealing with some of these special people.
Yeah, the nice thing about this is, you know, these are very big names, and you only when you sit with them and you talk to them, you realize that they're just ordinary people. That's the beauty of it. Mzwandi Lestik, who coached the World Cup as a backline coach, he's an amazing individual. You know, when I speak to him, it's like I'm speaking to a guy that I've known for ages, and he is not afraid to share his information or whatever he knows, which is beautiful. I mean, all of these guys, you're met Proudfoot, I think he's doing an amazing job. He did an amazing job. He's a World Cup winner. He knows exactly what he's talking about. And, you know, for these guys to come to an EPD camp, for example, to teach other coaches what they know, I think is planting a seed, a very good seed in South African rugby. And so the wheel will turn. Those who are learning will become teachers and so forth. Yeah. And yeah, just touch on Z. I think Z is doing a very good job there. He got a coaching gig in Kenya, and I've been following his matches, and so far he's unbeaten. He hasn't changed from the coach that he was at the Western Province schools to now. He's a hard worker, and yeah, I mean, these are all brilliant guys.
Definitely. So you mentioned it here, but the next step usually off of a national week is you get invited to join the EPD camps. You've been to a few. Talk to us about the experience of going to an EPD camp.
Yeah, first and foremost, I think it's a huge privilege to be invited at an EPD camp. At an EPD camp, I mean, you get to coach or to work with boys, the best of either under 16 or under 17 boys in the country. You know, that's a huge privilege. And so, yeah, I received a call from Nico Serfontaine, who actually invited me. I was over the moon. You know, I was doing a whole lot of planning. You know, I wanted, when I get there, you know, I need to be that guy that either shares or learn and do whatever it takes to you know, to play my part in SA Rugby. I think it's a great experience. You meet brilliant coaches. It's a time to network with you know, coaches that have been there or coaches that are doing what you are doing. And again, it's that South African culture of sharing and learning that takes place. I've met brilliant players at EPD camp, and sure, I would do it again in a nutbeat.
Yeah, absolutely brilliant initiative by Nico, who does EPD1, Herman, who does EPD2, Louis and Bufano, who's in charge of EPD3, and Barry McDonald. I think this is a great way to create a nice flow from the schoolboy system through to Springboks and what it looks like at the highest level. Great information that you share there. You become very motivated and inspired. Unfortunately, I haven't been to a physical one. I did the virtual one this year, but it was still pretty special. I think it's great to rub shoulders with these people. And like you say, it's an absolute honor. You don't deserve to be there. You're privileged to be there. Very special.
No, definitely. Definitely. 100%. Yeah, I checked you guys with the online one. I think it was very great.
Mm. Yeah. So, Coach Flash, obviously the next step would be to become the SA Schools coach. I'm sure you have that on your list of goals you want to achieve. Might not be too far into the future. But I think the value that we get from the EPD camps, like, for example, things like Stratus and talking to the SA Schools coaches, is also very important. I've also spoken to some of the other guys that say there's a lot of guys that go there and they have a little bit too much fun and they don't take it too seriously. So you've touched on the preparations. Advice for somebody who might go to a future EPD camp, what to do, what not to do?
First of all, go in there as two buckets. The first bucket is an empty bucket that needs to be filled with information, with knowledge. So make sure that you grab as many advice and as many knowledge, for lack of a better word, as possible. Learn a lot. And then the other bucket is whatever you know, make sure that you share it with others. So those are the two things, teach and learn. That's it. And obviously, I mean, it's a very serious camp. It's well organized. So play your part in it. You know, give your best and play your part in it.
Awesome. Great advice. Coach Flash, talk me through this next one.
Right. Now that's my son. That's my 5-year-old son, Tando Luetu. He's probably the only person I've stopped rugby for. My pride and joy. I spend a lot of time in the morning taking him to school and from school, and he drives me crazy. I think he makes me old. But yeah, I love him. Love him so much.
That's awesome, man. And those of us that follow you on social media can see you're a very, very proud dad and a very passionate dad. And I love watching the photos of you two together. There's so much swagger and confidence and happiness in your photos. It's always a joy to look at, and I really enjoy it.
Yeah, thanks. He keeps me alive. I'm enjoying fatherhood, and I mean, he just makes it so easy.
Awesome.
I love it.
Cool. So as we go back to rugby, I think you also did the 3D coach course last year. And again, yeah, a big thank you to Mr. Louis Kuhn, who mentioned this to all of us and created this opportunity. Talk to us about that experience.
Yeah, so the three-dimensional coaching is a very good course that I think anybody who's either a coach or an educator need to do. Anybody actually that works with athletes needs to go through this course. I highly recommend it. Just in a nutshell, it speaks about coaching a player in three dimensions, hence the name, which the first dimension is what we all do, which is on the field, teaching the skill and whatnot. And the second dimension will be everything that has to do with the mind. So coaching the mind, for example, coach how to coach confidence and so forth. And lastly, coaching the heart as well. So, you know, if you've ever heard of the saying that players would run a brick wall for a coach, that means they're doing that with the heart. So, yeah, I think a lot of us make a mistake in coaching just in one dimension.
Yeah.
But I think if we can touch, you know, the player's mind and the player's heart, it will, you know, whatever we are coaching would go a long way.
So, Coach, I believe you've had the experience as taking the course, and you've also been a presenter. How is it? How is the presenting part of it? Is that a good learning experience as well?
Yeah, I think when you're just there as a student, obviously you learn, but you'll be amazed how much you learn as an educator as well. So if you're presenting, there's things that you might have missed as a student that all of a sudden you need clarity on, and you get them so clear because you are now presenting. I've presented with a guy called Offensive Wing. We actually joined up and became co-presenters. I really enjoy those sessions. I really look forward to them every single time. When it's a Monday, I know there's a course coming, and it's been absolutely an honor, and it's been brilliant.
Yeah, a course I really enjoyed. It was a lot of fun, a great learning experience. And if there's anybody out there listening to this, if you haven't done the 3D course, I highly recommend it. And I'm going to make an effort to get Chris to speak on here to talk about it as well. He, I think, is the main guy in charge of it here in South Africa. Yeah, just a great course, man. It helps you to view coaching as more than just what's going on in the field, and really creating great humans and creating a passion between the teammates and stuff. Very, very cool. So, Coach, you're currently at Heron Bridge College, along with, as you've just mentioned, the gentleman, Offensive Moeng, who we also did an episode on. Talk to us a little bit of how did you get to this school? Why Heron College?
So Heron Bridge College is a school in the northern suburbs of Johannesburg. I've obviously taught at Tati Ethnic Diederichs, which is in Krugersdorp. And after that, I got an opportunity to come to Heron Bridge College. Earlier on in this interview, you asked me who do I look up to, and I mentioned a guy by the name Billy Benefeld, who was actually teaching at this school, and he invited me to come and play an under 14 festival, and I just fell in love with the way things were done there. And to my luck, there was a Mets post available, and I applied for it. And and then the rest was history. So yeah, it's a private school, but it's a beautiful school. Very young, less than 20 years old, I believe. So meaning that whatever you do, you can still create a sort of a culture within that school. It's a brilliant school.
How big is the high school component of it? How many learners?
So the high school, we're looking at about 550 learners, and that's boys and girls together. So it's not that big. It's not small either, but about 550 odd learners.
So on a Saturday when you guys have rugby, how many teams can you guys field?
Please repeat that.
How many rugby teams can you guys field on a Saturday?
Right, so we have 5 teams, which is the first and the second side. Those form our open groups, and then obviously we'll have the under-16s, under-15s, and under-14As. We can field 5 teams.
What does the first team coaching staff look like?
Right, so the first team coaches is myself. And we have a guy by the name Philip Fenter, who takes on the forwards. And we also have Billy Benefeld, who coaches the back line. Yeah.
Cool.
So just the three of us. And then obviously our SNC is a guy by the name of Mazur.
Cool. The rest of the teams, are they coached by educators or by outside experts?
So we have a lot of guys who are already in the staff coaching. At this stage, we don't have outside coaches, but we do at some point. For example, 2 years ago, we had an outside coach and that. But a lot of teachers who are, a lot of guys who are teachers at the school become rugby coaches. But we are open to outside coaches as well.
Yeah, and just for anybody who thinks that these are just normal teachers, just to give you a little bit of clarity, we're talking about Mr. Bielefeld, who is a role model of yours. We're talking about you, who's a teacher there, who's got all of this provincial skill experience and an EPD coach. We're talking about somebody like Ofensi Moheng, who's a former SA Schools manager, the current Craven Week Bulls coach, a member of SASRA. And we're talking about somebody like Lisa, who's recently joined you guys, who is a big expert and has also got a lot of experience. So these are not normal teachers. These are not guys who teach and like rugby. These are experts in their fields who will deliver high quality stuff.
Nah, definitely. These are good men as well. These are good men who love the game and who are passionate about what they do. I'm very privileged to work alongside them.
Awesome. As we wind down on the school questions, I know in the future we're going to do a full episode on rugby at the college. But can you tell us something interesting or something cool about rugby at the Heron Bridge College?
The first thing that pops into my mind is the 2018 season, which was a season where we achieved 100% win at first team level. I really, you know, memorize about 2018. It was everything just came together, and, you know, from friendlies to the league, to everything, to the seven aside, we were unbeaten, which was a very good season.
Awesome. Coach Flash, talk to us a little bit about your future plans. Where do you see yourself in the next couple of years? Where's Flash heading to for the next 5 to 10 years?
Right. So let me divide it into terms of what I do. So first and foremost, I'm an educator. So currently I am an HOD at my school. I want to tap into the space of a deputy principal. That's where my headspace is in. That's what I want to achieve going forward. And obviously, I coach rugby, and so I would really like to grow in the varsity space. Currently, I'm coaching the under 19s at UJ. Would love to see myself grow there into becoming a varsity cup coach, and also to tap into the professional side of coaching at a union.
Awesome. Can you give me some advice for young players out there that would like to be successful in the game of rugby?
Be coachable. The person who is standing in front of you coaching is there because they know exactly what they're talking about. So often as youngsters, we think we know it all, but it wouldn't hurt just to listen, observe, and do as the coaches say, because they know exactly what they are talking about. So be coachable and work hard.
Excellent advice. I think very simple, but a very important component. Coach Flash, if we can just briefly expand on this a little bit. I think the schoolboy game has changed so much with regards to the demand that the schoolboy now has on their coach. Have you noticed that change in the last, let's say, 5+ years?
Yeah, definitely. The game is turning into a very high performance and high pressured game. Definitely the game is evolving as the years go, and the demand for to achieve or to perform is really big. So definitely see it in that space. But I think what needs to happen as well is the minds of players. I think a lot of us are expecting more in the physical side of thing, not knowing that goes together with the mind. I think we need to do a lot when it comes to the mental space that the players are in, because it puts them in a lot of pressure mentally.
Speaking to that, I know you said that you like starting off your season by going away and doing something and building a bond. Are you one of those coaches that has a belief in we need to be together off the field as well? I'm not referring to social sessions, but off the field training as well. We talk about the mental, we talk about the mindset that we go into games with. Do you do anything like that?
Yeah, so with me, it's very important that we go away as rugby people. But in us going away, we do something that is not rugby related. For example, either we play golf or or we fish, for example. In that space, the guy who's probably most likely to be on the bench might be good at something and might be teaching the guy who's a first choice starting lineup, no doubt. In that sense, you get to learn people's highs and lows, people's advantages and disadvantages. And once you tap into that and you come together as men and you talk about it, the bond that you form outside of rugby will be seen inside the rugby space.
Awesome. Any advice to other coaches out there who would like to become successful?
Yeah, again, share a lot that you know and be open to learning other things as well. You know, I listened to someone saying he was involved in a team in New Zealand, and what they would do then is, whether you're a backline coach or a forwards coach, you were supposed to attend sessions. In that space, as a backline coach, you would attend a scrum session. So you're learning something new, something that is not related to what you do. But in you understanding what's going on in the forwards, you'll prepare better in the backline as well. So I think, just in a nutshell, be open to learning. And even if it's not something that goes with what you do specifically, but just learn.
Awesome. Something interesting that you've mentioned there, having the forwards looking at what the backs are doing, or vice versa. I think there is, we're one big team, but we tend to when the backs don't want to pass, like, ah, this flyer that only wants to carry the ball, or when the ball doesn't get to the backs, oh, these forwards just want to run over people. They get a little bit of perspective of maybe why it's done, and it's not necessarily something that's a selfish thing. There's a reason for it. I think that would create good synergy as well. Good point.
No, definitely. Once we understand each other and each other's struggles, we function better as human beings.
Mm. Tell me, how does Coach Flash stay up to date with trends? What do you do to keep upskilling yourself?
So I have what we call warriors. My warriors are, you know, my fellow coaches that I either work with or that I'm in contact with. We speak a lot. If there's a new trend, you know, we would discuss it. So yeah, I keep up with a lot of what's happening around me. I read a lot. It's just to stay in the game. I think you need to observe as much information as possible. So yeah, I have my warriors that we keep each other in check.
Awesome, awesome. YouTube, yes or no?
I think why not? Why not? I mean, if it's something that you will learn from, then yeah, be open to that. Some people learn by reading and some people learn by watching. So, you know, you might have players that learn by watching. So you know, we must use YouTube to educate.
Cool, yeah. The reason I ask is because I'm sure you've heard of the fact that there's this very controversial thing where people are called YouTube coaches. And we briefly spoke about this to MZ as well, where he's like, yeah, but there's different ways to view it. Like, you can be a YouTube coach, as in watch a video and try and apply that directly to your team. That's not very smart. But there's also a watch a couple of clips, learn from it, take what you can and convert into your beliefs and your philosophy what fits, rather than just go and say, oh, I saw this great move, we're going to do it this Saturday. But you actually need 110 kg inside center that can run a hard inside shoulder line. And if you don't have that, it's not going to work. And then it's like, oh, that is a YouTube coach. That's a guy who thinks, oh, yeah, this was a great move.
That's a very, very interesting way of looking at it. Just like not everything that's on the internet is true, I think not everything that will be on YouTube will work.
Yeah.
So you just need to know how to filter and to put in your flavor as well. You see. Make it your own. Definitely make it your own. But yeah, it's an interesting thing. I've never thought of it like that.
Yeah, that's a big thing in the Cape. There's a lot of coaches that have been called YouTube coaches. But anyway, moving away from that, how does Coach Flash stay motivated?
My son motivates me to be the best version of myself. And obviously, I look in the mirror a lot. I look at myself a lot. I do a lot of self. What's the word I'm looking for?
Self-reflection.
Yeah, I do a lot of self-reflection. So just to give you an example, I would, in the beginning, when the week starts, I would find 5 things that I want to do or that I want to achieve in the week. And after the week, I would sit down and reflect, have I achieved this? Why? Why not? You know, what is it that I can do? What are my new goals and so forth? So I speak to myself a lot and I reflect a lot. That keeps me going.
Cool. Tell me, Coach Flash, do you look to other sports sometimes for motivation or for trends or things? Do you, for example, look for links from football to rugby, or from basketball to rugby, or American football to rugby? Do you look for those type of inspirations, for lack of a better word?
So I do follow sports as well, other sports as well, not just rugby. But what I then do, I look at the culture that they have. I take a lot of the cultural influences of those sports. So not necessarily what they do on the field, I wouldn't take those trends, but how they got the team together, for example. You know, it can be a basketball team that was unsuccessful and something happened and then now they are successful. So I look a lot of into what happened. How did they achieve what they've achieved without looking at how they play on the field or any one dimension things that they do on the field.
Cool. Yeah, very interesting. Tell me, what did you think of chasing the sun, and did it have any sort of effect on your coaching philosophy?
Yeah, I think it was brilliant. Yeah, it was unbelievable. It's you know, there were moments when I thought, "Ooh, we are so fortunate to be in this country," you know, with so much diversity, and you know, when we get it right, you know, it just becomes magical. I think it was well put. Whoever shot those footages were brilliant, and the storyline behind it is South African. And yeah, that's the beauty of being in this country. And you know, rugby is so huge in South Africa that it touches lives, different lives from all sorts of areas. Yeah, I think Chasing the Sun was excellent.
Cool. As we start winding down here, and again, Coach, thank you very much for your time. What does the game of the future look like to you? I know we have a guy on our Kaizen group, Nick. He loves asking this question, so I'm going to throw this one to you. What does the game of the future look like in the next 5 years for you?
I'd say exciting, very, very high performing, and it would be, I would say, creative. We're seeing a lot of very creative coaches that are trying to do a lot of things. So yeah, it's high tempo and creative. That's how I see the game in the future.
How do you see the Lions series going later on this year?
Because I'm going to be very, very, very biased. I've the Lions coming this side. I think the Springbok are ready for them. I really hope that we give out a good performance against the British Lions. And yeah, I'm confident. We're number one in the world. I have so much confidence that the Bucks will win the series.
I think there's a lot of people in the public out there that are nervous because the Bucks haven't played since the World Cup. Listen, if you think Rassie and Jock have been sitting on their butts and been doing nothing for the last year and a half, you are insane. You think those guys haven't been doing camps and haven't had one-on-ones and haven't kept those guys on a training program and a nutritional program and skills development, then you don't know who Rassie and Jock are. They're never going to leave those guys alone. I also firmly believe we're going to surprise people. Definitely. Definitely.
I think
because they've been playing the whole 2 years and they're like, these guys haven't played in 2 years. Yeah. We'll talk again in the end of August.
No, definitely. I think the biggest issue at the moment is team selection. It would be very interesting to see which nation will sort of dominate the Lions. But yeah, I think the Bucks are ready. We'll look forward to watching every single one of those games.
Awesome, Flash. Last one from me. Obviously, you're at Heron Bridge College along with Ofense. Ofense is a guy we also did an episode with. Lots of experience there. Talk to us about having that guy sitting next to you in staff meetings and being able to bounce off of him on a daily basis.
So it's an interesting one. Ofense, if you don't know Ofense, he loves to send voice notes. He never texts or call, he sends you voice notes, and all of those voice notes are about rugby, what we need to do, what I think about this, what I think about this move and whatnot. It's such a healthy space because you're sitting with a guy that speaks your language in terms of rugby quality. And a guy who wants to improve all the time. I think it's brilliant. And to have Lisa also coming over, it will be such a huge benefit. It's great. I'm loving it.
Awesome. Yeah, I'm very jealous. Very jealous. So, Coach Flash, if I can reminisce a little bit here, do you remember where we met?
So either on the National Week was it in either Bloemfontein or Cape Town? Where was it?
Do you remember we had the National Schools coaches had the camp at Stellenbosch in 2019, just before the National Week?
Yes,
That's where we
Cape
met.
Cape Town, yes.
So I saw you there, and I just want to tell you the story because it's so interesting. So we had Bobby, you know Bobby?
Yeah, Western Province, yeah.
So we were sitting there having a meal, and I think you came and sit next to us, and Bobby came with like these 10 cans of Coke. I don't know if you remember the story. And like drops on the table, and he's like, if you know my name, you can grab a can. So I saw your facial expression was so funny. You looked up at him and you said, well, so I don't know your name, but can I have a bottle? Can I have a can as well? I thought that was so funny. And since then, I've been following you, and we've sort of became friends through the 2020 year where we haven't been coaching, and you've shared a lot of stuff that you were part of, and I sort of asked your advice and got some of the information from you. And it's just been a lot of fun. Like I say, the slogan of this series is people that coach the game because they've got a passion for it. And I think you're one of those guys that are just, your passion is infectious. And the way you do things is so, it's such an honest and a hardworking, it's driven by honesty and hard and a work ethic, which I think is something great for any coach to aspire to. So I definitely wanted to do an episode with you, not just because of your coaching experience, but because I believe you are one of the people with a lot of passion for the schoolboy game and just a lot of passion for the game in general. So yeah, you're a great guy. I've enjoyed getting to know you. Although we haven't seen each other that much, we spent a lot of time talking on Zooms and the Kaizen group and emails and WhatsApps. And it's been a lot of fun to tap into your sources as well. And I'm very excited to see where the future takes you.
No, man, thank you. Thank you very much. I think it's a great thing that you are doing, getting those, you know, interviewing these coaches. And that, I think it's what the country needs, to get to know each other. If we know each other, then we can work. We can function in a nice, healthy way together. I think you're doing a fantastic job, and I'm honored to be part of this. I'm honored to be one of the guys that you chose to interview. I can't thank you enough.
No, look, the pleasure is all mine, and this is just fun for me, man. It's just fun to talk to like-minded people that view the game the same way that I do, that have the same passion for it. It's just a lot of fun. And if there's other people out there that want to listen to the conversations, I think the big thing that I wanted to do is, I spoke to someone recently about this as well, is I was an absolute idiot and just a naive person in 2014 when I was very critical about the SA schools coaches and the weak performances. And then I got into the system and I heard how difficult it is to coach that team where you've got a week. And it's not like a week of preparation. There's a whole bunch of other things going on and you've got to find synergy between all these players. And I just kind of felt like I really wanted people to listen to the person behind the team, right? We always just go, and if the team is good, it's the coaches. It's not the coach, it's great players. The team is poor, it's the coach. So I just wanted to take a peek behind the curtain, right? We've heard of SA Schools. We've heard of the Lions. We've heard the name Flash before. Let's find out who Flash is, and then hopefully people will be a little bit more understanding towards our coaches, because it's a tough job out there. It's a tough job.
No, definitely. It's not easy. Even though you're working with the best athletes in the country, it's not an easy one. You know, the time thing that you've just mentioned now, a week to prepare, it's not an easy one. And the guys who sort of give good results, I mean, big ups to those guys. They deserve all the glory.
Awesome. Coach Flash, again, thank you so much for your time. Enjoy the rest of your weekend, and hopefully we'll see you next to the pitch soon. Cheers.
Thank you so much, man. Have a good one. Thanks.